So welcome back. So this is a module, very important module, where we're going to discuss two very important things. In every hospital and in a non-hospital situation, there are a lot of laboratories that we have to deal with. Now these laboratories are very, very, very serious environments because there's a huge chance of infection in these laboratories. And there have been some classification to classify these laboratories, and that is based on biosafety. So they have classified it according to biosafety levels. And there's also an accreditation body called the NABL, which we are going to discuss in this module. So first, I want to tell you about what is the meaning of biosafety. Now, biosafety level is a set of biocontainment precautions required to isolate dangerous biological agents in an enclosed laboratory facility. Now, what does that mean? That in a laboratory, there are some substances which can pose a threat to humans, because that's where they're in huge concentration. We are using the lab to check it. But how do we classify them? So we classify them according to the risk that they pose. So risk has been classified into four levels. There is risk level group 1, 2, 3 and 4. Risk level 1 talks about that the microorganism that we are testing or that we are looking at is unlikely to cause any disease. In the risk group 2, the pathogen can cause human or animal disease, but it's unlikely to be serious hazard to lab workers, the community, livestock or the environment. Laboratory exposures may cause serious infection, but effective treatment and preventive measures are available and the risk of infection spread is limited. Now in the risk group 3, there is high individual risk but low community risk. Now what does that mean? That the pathogen usually causes serious human or animal disease but does not necessarily ordinarily spread from one infected individual to another, and effective treatment and preventive measures are available. Now the fourth is very serious, high individual and high community risk. Pathogen usually causes serious human or animal disease and can be readily transmitted from one individual to the other. And that can be like direct transfer or indirect transfer, and effective treatment and preventive measures usually are not available. So for this category, we have to be really, 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 really careful. So apart from this, there are other factors, not only these risk factors. So there are other factors that we have to look at. And these are pathogenicity of the agent, potential outcome of exposure, natural route of infection, other routes of infection resulting from lab manipulations like, you know, airborne or ingestion or something which happens through some human intervention. Then we have to look at the stability of the agent in the environment, the concentration of the agent and the volume of the concentrated material to be manipulated, presence of suitable host, information available from animal studies and reports of lab acquired infections, and there are some more. So we are going to share with you a very important resource, which is from the World Health Organization. It's a laboratory biosafety manual, which is by the World Health Organization, made along with CDC. So this we're going to share, and it's going to give you a detail of what all we have to take care to make a good laboratory, and we are also going to discuss it now. Now, there are four biosafety levels. Now, we have studied now risk groups. Now, we will see ki there are biosafety levels. There are four biosafety levels. Biosafety level 1, 2, 3 and 4. Biosafety level 1 is low risk microbes, and biosafety level 4 is high risk microbes. First, we are going to look at, so what all is the relation of risk group of biosafety practices and equipment. I'm just going to give you a very brief idea. If I look at biosafety level 1, you know, that is a lab where basic teaching or research happens. And, you know, there is no safety equipment as such. All the experiments are done in an open bench, you know. Now, if we compare that to biosafety level 2 laboratory, there open bench is there, plus there is a BSC for potential aerosols. What is a BSC? We're going to talk to you later. Now, what is this used for? So, first one was used for basic teaching and research. This one is used for primary health services, diagnostic services, and research. Primary health services, lot of human beings coming. Diagnostic services, people are coming to get their checks done. So, all this is done where? In biosafety level 2 laboratory. Now, if we compare this to biosafety level 3 lab, here special diagnostic services is happening, and here we have to be even more careful. In the fourth biosafety level, we are going to discuss all of the four in detail. In the fourth one, there is a dangerous pathogen units. These are dangerous pathogen units, pathogens which do not have proper preventive, and sometimes there's no cure available for these pathogens. So we have to be really, really, really careful. So first, let's talk about the biosafety level 1. If you work in a lab that is designated biosafety level 1, microbes that are not known to consistently cause disease in healthy adults and present minimum potential hazard to laboratories and the environment are the microbes that we look at in this laboratory setting. An example of a microbe that is typically worked in a BS1 lab, so the short form for biosafety level 1 lab is BS1 or BSL1, that is a E. coli bacteria. So E. coli bacteria is a non-pathogenic bacteria which we can study easily in biosafety level 1 lab. Now, what are the laboratory practices that are followed in a BSL1 lab? Standard microbial practices are followed. Work can be done in an open bench or table. Safety equipment is like personal protective, lab coats, gloves, eyewear. Such protection are still provided. The facility construction is such that a sink must be available for hand washing, and lab should have doors that separate the working area with the rest of the facility. So we are going to share with you some images of how the plan of a biosafety 1 lab looks like in the references. Now we look at the biosafety level 2 lab. Now a biosafety level 2 lab is nothing different. It is something that we build on top of a biosafety level 1 lab. So if you work in a lab that is designated BSL2, the microbes that pose moderate hazard to laboratorians, like the people who are working in the labs and the environment, are moderate hazards. The microbes are typically, you know, indigenous and associated with disease of varying severity. Example is Staphylococcus aureus. This bacteria is very commonly checked for in the surveillance departments, infection control departments of many hospitals in India. So in addition to BSL1 consideration, BSL2 labs have, you know, some special practices, like access to lab is restricted when work is being conducted. So it's a restricted access lab when there's work going on. Then access is one very important thing. We also look at the safety equipment. Appropriate personal protective measures are to be provided, like lab coats, eye protection, face shields, and all procedures are done in a BSC. I told you before what is BSC, I was about to tell you. So BSC is a biological safety cabinet. Basically, it's a cabinet where the air is controlled so that air that is inside the BSC doesn't come to the laboratorian who's working. So that is a BSC. So there's no aerosol, no splash from the specimen that you are working on, and causes no threat to the lab officer or the lab person working in the lab in front of a BSC. So another important thing is autoclave. autoclave is an alternative method of decontamination and it's available for proper disposal. Now there are some important factors for facility construction, like the laboratory has to have self-closing doors. See, as architects, as facility managers, designers, hospital administrators, we have to make sure that a BSL level 2 lab has a auto closing door. Very small input but can lead to great amount of biosafety. And another important thing is a sink and an eye wash. What is a sink and an eye wash? Sink we all know. What is an eye wash? So if you are working in a lab and suddenly there is an acid spill, or suddenly there is a, you know, contaminated sample which spills and falls into your, onto your face or onto your eyes, what do? You immediately run. In the center of the lab, you don't have to go to the washroom, sink or anything. There is a specialized equipment where you just have to put your face, and from two spouts, you have to use a foot lever and water jets out of that and comes to your eyes and it clears your eyes. In some facilities, along with the eye, there is also a full body wash. You have to pull a lever and the full body gets a shower. That is to prevent you from any kind of contamination or spillage. Now we are giving you a plan of the BSL 2 lab. Now you have to look at the plan in the references which we are going to provide you. Now we look at what is the BSL 3 lab. Again, BSL 3 builds up on a BSL 2 lab. It's not in isolation. It is one step further from a BS 2 lab. So if you're working in a BSL 3 lab, microbes can be either indigenous or exotic, and they can cause serious or potentially lethal diseases through respiratory transmission. So you can, you know, breathe in this air and that can cause some kind of a lethal disease to the person who's working. Now respiratory transmission, you know, is a inhalation route of exposure like many others. Ingestion is another one. For example, one example of microbe that is typically worked in a BSL 3 lab is TB bacteria called Mycobacterium TB. So if you're a researcher working to find a new medicine of TB, or if you are working, you know, if you are a lab of a TB hospital where you're trying to do sputum analysis to check whether the particular person has tuberculosis or not, you have to do all that testing in a BSL 3 lab. Otherwise, you are putting yourself, other lab staff, and the environment and the community at risk. So, in addition to the requirements of BSL 2, there are other requirements like, you know, they have to be under medical surveillance. Who has to be under medical surveillance? The lab technicians. That means they have to get immunizations and they have to be checked periodically, whether after so many, you know, units of time, months or days or weeks, have they contracted anything? Even after all the precautions that we still have to have full surveillance of this staff. Access has to be totally restricted at all times, totally controlled through access systems, you know, the touch cards or something like that, or fingerprints, you know, it has to be totally secured. Now, safety equipment, very important. So lab coats are obviously worn. There are also respirators which have to be worn. You know, there are some, so in typical language we call them masks. So these are special masks which have to be worn. Then it should be performed in an appropriate BSC. BSC, I've already told you. So what usually what happens in such labs is there is a standard protocol for different bacteria. So they designate one particular BSC for a typical microbe. So that there's no cross contamination and people know, oh, this BSC is for this bacteria or this microbe. So what do we have to look at from the facility construction point of view? We have to make sure that there is a hands-free sink. What is a hands-free sink? A hands-free sink is a sink which is operated, you know, not with your hands, like typical sinks, with a foot lever or an elbow lever, something like that. So the hands are not contaminating the sink, and the next person who comes to the sink doesn't get contaminated with whatever you were working with before. Then eye wash, very important. Sometimes with eye wash, shower is also provided. Exhaust air cannot be recirculated. I repeat, exhaust air should not be recirculated. A typical split air conditioner would recirculate the exhaust air. You have to have a special arrangement where there is no recirculation of the exhaust air. And laboratory must have sustained directional airflow. You know, like laminar airflow, huh? Laminar airflow is where there's a one direction airflow, so that there is no, so once something passes from point A to B, that should not come back from B to A, because the flow is in one direction. Then entrance to the lab is through two sets of self-closing and locking doors. What is two sets? So it creates some kind of an anteroom. What is an anteroom? So this is, there's a lab and then there's a door. In between these two, there's a small buffer space. That buffer space is provided so that there is an airlock. So you go inside, you open one door, you stand in the buffer space, the first door closes, then you go to the second door, that door opens. So what happens? It creates an airlock. All these things very important for a BSL 3 lab. Now we are going to share with you a layout view of the BSL 3 lab. Now very important, very crucial, you know, some labs, you know, you will see will not be BSL 4, some hospitals might not have BSL 4 labs, but these are very crucial labs and they are built, you know, on top of a BSL 3 lab. This is the highest level of biological safety, you know. Dangerous, exotic, aerosol transmitted infections are the ones worked on in this kind of a lab. These are infections caused by microbes which are frequently fatal. They will kill you and they are without treatment or vaccine. Can you give me an example? Ebola. So if you are working with Ebola, you have to be working with a BSL 4 lab only, please. You see on television, people are working on Ebola control, Ebola news. They are wearing those full gowns with respirators and so many controls. Why are they doing it? Because Ebola treatment is still under testing. It is not being developed. It is not developed like to the level where it is commercial worldwide. So we have to be very careful with Ebola and we have to have a BSL 4 lab. So now BSL 4 labs have specific, you know, contaminant requirements. So there are some laboratory practices that we have to follow. This is very crucial stuff. They have to be changing of clothes before you enter. So you cannot be wearing the same lab coat in the hospital or in the healthcare facility, and you cannot enter the, you know, BSL 4 lab. You have to change the clothes and get into proper gowns before you enter. You also have to take a shower before you exit. You have to decontaminate all the materials before you exit. And you have to have some degree of safety equipment. What is the safety equipment? All work to be done in a class 3 BSc. And that has to be done by a full body air supplied positive pressure unit. Full body includes your face. Air supplied, separate air unit supplies you air, and it is a like a positive pressure suit that you are wearing. Then facility construction, very important as architects, as engineers, as hospital administrators, facility managers, you have to understand that there is a separate building. The whole laboratory is a separate building. It is not a floor in any other building. You have to have a separate, isolated, restricted building, right? So in certain cases you don't have, you know, you cannot have a separate isolated building, so then you do a restricted zone in a building in certain cases, but try to make sure that a BSL floor lab is an isolated structure on its own. So when you are designing the air conditioning or the ventilation system for a BSL 4 lab, you have to be very careful. And one way of being careful is by having a dedicated supply and an exhaust air dedicated unit for a BSL 4 lab. There has to be separate vacuum lines, separate decontamination systems. This under any circumstance cannot be mixed with another area or another lab. You know, sometimes we have two labs together and we try to give it a single AHU. We cannot do that. We have to give a separate AHU, separate decontamination system for a BSL 4 lab. Now there is a summary chart which gives us a comparison between what all is required in all the four biosafety levels. We are just going to give you a type of a sample to give an example as to the difference. This chart is being shared with you in the references. So like for example, isolation of laboratory is not required for biosafety level 1 and 2, required for 3 and 4. Airlock not required for 1 and 2, required for 3 and 4. Anteroom not required for 1, 2 and 3, but required for 4. And you know, like personal safety monitoring capability, like whether the personnel are safe, not required for 1 and 2, desirable for 3. And definitely required for 4. Then autoclave on site, not required for 1, desirable for 2, required for 3, required for 4. Then effluent treatment, not required for 1 and 2, 3 desirable, 4 definitely yes. And in 3 also, you know, it's about depends upon the kind of microbes that you're dealing with. Then ventilation system, inward flow is one factor. Controlled ventilation system is another factor. HEPA filtered exhaust is another factor. So inward airflow not required in 1 biosafety, desirable in 2nd, required in 3rd and required in 4th. HEPA filter not required in 1st, not required in 2nd, and it is desirable in 3rd and definitely required in 4th. So these are some of the things, a small little summary that we are going to give you as a reference. So, you know, there is a very important, when you are making the signages for your hospitals, you know, sometimes we leave the signages at the last moment, but we must do quality research on the signages, making sure they are properly colored, making sure they follow all the international conventions. So every time you are making a lab, you have to give a biohazard emblem that has to be put, which we are sharing. This biohazard emblem has to be put right on the front door of the lab. It also has to mention the biosafety level of the lab, who's the responsible investigator of the lab. In case of an emergency, you have to have a quick emergency number put right at the door, not somewhere inside the lab, you know, where you have to open a book or something, right at the door. Daytime phone, home phone of the person, all the instructions given right at the door itself to really make people aware of what precautions they have to take. Now, there is a thing called guinea pigs or lab rats. Now, whenever we're doing medical research, we do it on guinea pigs or animal rats, usually mammals, you know, something like mice or, you know, really guinea pigs. So why do we do that? Because we want to test a certain medication, test a certain condition, test a certain diagnostic on these animals. So in some situations, we also have to have a laboratory animal facility. So those who use animals for experimental and diagnostic purposes have a moral obligation to take care to avoid causing any unnecessary pain or suffering to these animals. These animals must be provided with comfortable, hygienic housing and adequate, wholesome food and water. At the end of the experiment, they must be dealt in a humane manner. For security reasons, the animal house should be independent, detached unit. If it adjoins a lab, you know, then the design should provide for its isolation from the public parts of the lab, you know, such, and if there is a need like that. And for this, there has to be proper decontamination and disinfection. Now, there are many types of animal safety contamination levels, you know, and like 1, 2, 3, 4, and these will be provided in the references. So we have to make sure that we design good laboratory animal safe animal facilities, and not only for providing humane treatment to animals, these animals have to be given a uniform conditions in which they are living, so that they do not get any kind of an external influence or infection from the environment. If that happens, then they will show false results for our experiments. So not only from the humane point of view, also for good experiment point of view, they have to be provided a good facility with all the precautions. Now, there is a need for laboratories to adjust priorities to meet the challenges of emerging or re-emerging infectious diseases. In order to ensure that adaptation and maintenance are undertaken promptly and in an appropriate and safe manner, all biological research and clinical labs should be regularly certified. So, we are going to share with you, you know, an example of a BSC, different type of BSC or biological safety cabinet. You know, laminar flow is to be provided in it, HEPA filter is to be provided in it, how there is a screen in front so that there is no spillage or there is, you know, no contamination to the face of the person who's working. Now, when I say this line, I am trying to hint at the next part of this module, that is certification and accreditation of laboratories. And the body that does that work in India is NABL. Now, why do we need laboratory certification? Because it ensures that proper engineering controls are being used and they are functioning adequately as they were designed. Appropriate site and protocol specific administrative controls are in place. Personal protective equipment is appropriate for the task being performed. And decontamination of waste material and other materials has been adequately considered, and proper waste management procedures are in place. Proper procedures for general lab safety, including physical, electrical and chemical safety, are in place. So all these things are important so that the lab as a whole functions properly the way it is designed, so that proper experiments can happen in the lab. So what is accreditation? Accreditation is a third party attestation related to conformity assessment body, conveying the formal demonstration of its competence to carry out specific conformity and assessment task. After the liberalization of trade in India, what happened? There is an increased consciousness. Now we want to be very careful that we are getting proper quality everywhere. So same thing in labs. There is an increased consciousness for quality, and this is done to match international levels of acceptable competence. Laboratory accreditation is when somebody having an authority, who is the authority in India? NABL. So when somebody having an authority gives a formal recognition of a technical competence for specific tests and measurements based on third party assessment and also complying to standards set internationally. So who is it for? So who all can go to NABL and get accreditation? You can be a testing laboratory, you can be a calibration laboratory, you can be a medical laboratory, you can be a proficiency testing provider, or you can be a reference material producer. Now, a testing laboratory is biological, chemical, electrical, electronics, fluid flow, mechanical, non-destructive testing, radiological, thermal, forensic. Calibration, electrotechnical, mechanical, fluid flow, thermal and optical, radiological. Medical lab, clinical biochemistry, clinical pathology, hematology, immunohematology, microbiology and serology, histopathology, cystopathology, genetics, nuclear medicine, in vitro tests only. So these are the services provided by NABL. These are the kind of labs that they are going to certify. Benefits of accreditation. Why do we need accreditation in the first place? Increased confidence in testing, calibration reports issued by the lab. So they are gold standard. You can go there with confidence and you can rest assured that they have, you know, they have passed a test and they are giving you proper reports. And then second, another point is better control of laboratory operations and feedback to laboratories as to whether they have sound quality assurance system, huh? And they are technically competent. It becomes a feedback system for them. Potential increase in business due to enhanced customer confidence and satisfaction. Customers can search and identify the labs accredited by NABL for their specific requirements from the NABL website or directory of accredited laboratories. So users of accredited laboratories enjoy greater access for their products in both domestic and international markets. Savings in terms of time and money due to reduction or elimination of need for retesting of products. So you know, you've gone to a accredited lab, they have given you proper results, so you don't have to go another lab for second opinion. So there is a process that you have to follow. Now, why is the process important in this module? Because you have to understand that all this is governed by certain international and Indian standards. There's a process available on the NABL website that you have to look at, you know, how you have to go. You have to fill a proper form. Your form number is NABL 151 for testing labs, 152 for calibration lab, and so on. Three copies have to be provided, huh? And then there have to be, all this has to be done according to a quality manual, which one? ISO 17025-2005, ISO 15189-2012. ISO 17043-2010 or ISO 17034-2016, whichever is applicable in your case. All this has to be given with a proper fee, and you know, this will then be processed by the NABL secretariat. So all this process is available, but what we have to get from this is that this is following an ISO standard for management system of the lab. So that is also that. So along with accreditation by NABL, you're also following the parameters of ISO standards. So we have just found out that it is very important to get the accreditation done. We have also seen key what are the benefits of accreditation, and we've just touched on the process of applying for accreditation. You can go to the website and look at what is the process, how it fits your particular lab, and then you have to apply. That application follows a particular procedure. So how is NABL globally recognized? So NABL has linkages with international bodies like International Laboratory Accreditation Cooperation and Asia Pacific Accreditation Cooperation. So NABL is a full member of ILAC, APAC, and you know, NABL is signatory to ILAC, APAC manual recognition arrangements. So it is not working in isolation, it's working at par with the standards across the globe. NABL operations in itself. So you know, when you are an accreditation body, you are giving accreditation to others, so you yourself have to be accredited, so they are confirming to ISO 17011-2017. So in this module we have covered a lot. We have seen biosafety levels, what are the requirements of their labs, and what are the NABL accreditation process benefits, and what is NABL. So NABL also would want you to have biosafety levels, so they will take it for granted that you have followed the biosafety levels which you have studied in this module. Then only they will talk further and talk about the accreditation. So this was this module. We studied a lot. We'll give you reference materials. Then there'll be a small test. Make sure you do that well. So it was great being with you. Thank you. Jai Hind.